Hello and welcome to Newsclick. Today we are in Bangladesh in the sidelines of Asian Assembly for People's Movement and Organizations in Dhaka. We have Mr. Rashed Khan Menon, who is the Minister of Social Welfare and also the President of Workers' Party of Bangladesh. Thank you, Mr. Menon. Mr. Menon, the first question itself, which is out of curiosity. Your name as Menon, which is mostly used in southern parts of India. What is the context of this?
Well, the context is that my father was very fond of Mr. Krishna Menon in those days of independence struggle against the British. So when I was born, my father gave me this as a nickname. But everybody knew like by my nickname. Nobody called me by my own name. Everybody called me by my nickname. When I came to the college, so one of the great artists of Bangladesh, he just drawn the masthead of our World magazine, in which he gave me name as R.K. Menon. And after that, I used to write my name within bracket Menon, otherwise nobody would have known me by that. Even in during my university election days, there are two Rasheds, so I had to distinguish as Menon. So the people won't be popular. So at one time this bracket has just gone away. I am known as Menon. Everybody knows me as Menon. That's how it has stuck to my name.
Okay. So now I think I can call you Menon than
yes.
Rashed. Okay.
Everybody calls me Menon. So,
so Mr. Menon, you have literally lived through three eras. One is British India. You were born in 43. And then Pakistan, and now Bangladesh. You have seen a lot of struggles, you have been part of a lot of struggles, now you are part of the Workers' Party of Bangladesh. You spoke in the Asian Assembly, in the inaugural address, that capitalism and neoliberalism are the threat for this world today, and we need to unite. Can you elaborate this thing?
Well, I said that it's very though it was not a very long speech, but even then I was quite candid about one thing, that now the world is being ruled by only a set of people. The whole the wealth of the world is now concentrated in the hand of, as I said in that paper, that 8 man controls about 50% of the wealth of the world. So 8 man controls about 300 crore people's life. And not only that, it is the corporations and others who are determining the decisions making process of every country. Even in Bangladesh, where the capital has not developing that way, the multinational companies are definitely has a role to play in this country also. So, and after the fall of Soviet Union, or the dismantling of the Soviet Union, and the setback of the socialism, now the capitalism has its a free hand in the world. And what happened is that now to that the every bad things of capitalism has entered into society. Consumerism and only selfishness and other things, that has become the go of the day. Unfortunately, during our days when we are young people, we used to look for the good of the country, good of the people, welfare, emancipation of people. Now, I find the young people that they are confined to themselves. They desire that immediately they take a job, they'll have a flat and a car, and they'll live their life like that. So this is the effect in our country also. And not only that, the process of the neoliberalism, the deprivation process has increased much more. Difference between rich and the poor has increased. In our country also, the Gini coefficient, as is, which measures the income gap. They say that it is increasing. Not only in the case of the rich urban people, but also in the case of the rural people also, and that is more greater than the urban people. And in this way, the people are being deprived, and not only economically, now they are being deprived of their rights also. They are exercising the, all the governments have become authoritarian. Even in the Gabon democracy, they have become authoritarian. You can see everywhere in the world.
You said about the increasing gap, which we see in South Asia. The rich are becoming rich. I mean, the richer are becoming rich, more and more rich, and the poor are becoming more and more poor. Also, what is threatening the South Asian region, including Bangladesh and India, is the rising religious fundamentalism. In Bangladesh itself, we recently we have witnessed attacks on activists, bloggers. How do you think that as your party,
Well, unfortunately, what happened is that, you know, the liberation of Bangladesh was fought on the basis of a non-communal democratic, for the non-communal and democratic rights. And the, immediately after the formation of liberation of Bangladesh, the constitution included that secularism and democratic rights and other socialism also in our four principles of our constitution. But 3 years, 3.5 years after that liberation, the founder of the nation was assassinated.
Very unfortunate.
Very unfortunately, by the military rulers. And when they came in, they just threw away this principle of secularism and everything from the constitution. Not only that, they rehabilitated those people who were the collaborators of the Pakistani army. So they were brought back to this country, they were given the citizenship, they were given the postal positions. This how it has, at the same time, the world, in the world also something has happened is that the Middle Eastern petrodollar had a very great influence in our country. Now, you know, many of our people are now working in Saudi Arabia and the Middle East. So that influence is also coming to Bangladesh. And you know, the Saudis, therefore, they follow the Wahhabi system, the most extremist form of Islam. And so they supported these forces who were against Bangladesh, who fought against our people, who killed our people, who raped our people. They were brought back and financed by these people. You know, the Islamic Bank, the first Islamic bank, now it is the biggest bank in Bangladesh, was established mainly with the help of the Saudis. The ambassador was there, his name is Khatib, he was the pioneer of the in stabilizing his bank. And all the people of Jamaat Islami and others were brought in, became their director and other things. So in the economic factor, in the economic sector, they just got their entrenchment in the economic sector also. And the 21 years of the military rule and the other rule, what happened is that this has spread throughout the country. Now, with the influence of petrodollar, with the influence of Wahhabism, with the influence of other forces outside, jihad and other jihadist forces outside, now a sort of in Bangladesh, a change is coming, unfortunately. The change is that in the mindset of the people, now religion is getting deeper and deeper root. And that religion is not the religion that we practice in our country, because in our country we practice the Sufism, mainly the liberal kind of Islam in our country. It was followed by our people. Our forefathers used to do that. Now the extreme ideas has come in, and now we they are influencing the, our young people and other people. What happened, you see, in this Istima, you are seeing that is, what is happening, today has closed, about millions of people were there, and there also, the division is very sharp, the extremists and the liberal ones, the division is very sharp. So this has made a ground for the rise of the Islamism and the military people, and after that, that the coalition of BNP, the Bangladesh Nationalist Party and Jamaat Islami helped these forces to grow further, and at that time this Islamic militancy developed in our country. Now with the rise of IS in the Middle East, particularly in Iraq and Syria. So they have already influenced by young people. And you know now the internet is the best thing to influence people. So by that way, it has influenced.
Mr. Menon, in Bangladesh, there is a rise of Islamic fundamentalism. In India, we see there is a rise of religious Hindu fundamentalism. And in Myanmar, there is a rise of Buddhist fundamentalism. And in this context, a lot of attack on against the Rohingya populations happened in Myanmar. And most of these Rohingyas, who are stateless people, have come to Bangladesh. And Bangladesh is one of the few countries which has opened doors for these refugees and provided humanitarian aid, when a lot of other countries in South and Southeast Asia closed their doors. Recently, Bangladesh government has signed an agreement with the Myanmar authorities about reparation, safe reparation of these refugees back to Myanmar. But there are also reports that post-agreement, few of the Myanmar, Rohingya villages were also burnt in Myanmar. So, how do you see that there can be a safe reparation of these refugees back to Myanmar? Is there any monitoring process?
Number one is that Bangladesh has opened up its border for the Myanmar people. Now the total number has come down to about 1 million. And just the people who just came in recently, about 600,000, of them 70,000 are pregnant women. And during the last 3 months, about 30,000 marked were there. So you know what problem is Bangladesh is now facing. So Bangladesh had no other option but to go for a negotiation with them, because though there is a world support, UN support and other supports are coming, but Myanmar is a neighbor, because we have to live with the neighbor. So we thought that, we felt that it should be sorted out bilaterally first and then the others should come in. Now, after that, because we had an agreement in 1992 about the Rohingyas who were repatriated in Myanmar once in 1992, about 30,000 of them, but it stopped there. So we don't believe that Myanmar is going to respect the agreement, but we have to go through that process. Number one, because two things are very important here. You know, the China and India, both as they are not taking any side. They are trying to remain neutral about it. Rather, China is saying that it is an internal affair of Myanmar, should be dealt like that. And India is just keeping mum all the time. So it is becoming very difficult for Bangladesh to maneuver in that way. So we have to go for an agreement with them for repatriation. But in the repatriation, we propose, and it has been said, that in the repatriation process, the UNHCR will be involved. So UNHCR should be there to oversee
monitoring and safe hands.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Menon, for speaking to Newsclick. Thank you for watching Newsclick. Please log into our website www.newsclick.in. Thank you.